Okay, time to whine about what's going on in my life right now for, for the beginning of this review, because I think this film kind of got to me on a very personal level. Now, in Korea, not a lot of cultures thrive. It's usually about being a part of a group, or you need to listen to your teachers and whatnot. And within this culture, I just kind of decided to do whatever the fuck I want and watch whatever the fuck I want. And thankfully, my mother supported that at a very young age. My mother just allowed me to watch R-rated movies or X-rated films as long as they were not porn. And even now, my mom doesn't really like the fact that I watch porn, but what can you do? But there were seven things that my mom really did not want me to do. And these were murder, drinking, rape, smoking cigarettes, stealing stuff, gambling, and drugs. Now, obviously, murder. I'm not gonna kill anybody because I think I'm too insecure for that. I can't drink because I have like a genetic liver problem that my father has and my grandfather also has it. He actually found cancer cells just a few years back, and thankfully we got rid of it because it was in the early stage. So obviously, I can't drink. I don't think. Here's the thing. Even if I rape somebody, I don't think I can be a good rapist. I'm just no, I'm that's just not my game. I'm not a big smoking fan, never was fond I was never really fond of the smell of cigarettes. Yeah, stealing, too clumsy for that. I'm too petty for gambling. I'll probably kill myself if I lose like 50 cents. But drugs were something else. Drugs intrigued me, and although a lot of people told me it's overrated, it's not really worth your time, and my mother always told me that it'll kill you, although my mother doesn't know shit about drugs because she never done it, because marijuana, just like even marijuana is illegal in every single place in Korea. So obviously, nobody really knew anything about drugs, especially the people who told me not to do it. But in Korea it's kind of hard to get drugs or experience getting high, so usually I'll try to find it in art. Whether it's in musical form, I'll try to listen to, like, psychedelic rock or dream pop or shoegaze, all that reverbed shit. And with films, I would go to Terry Gilliam, Federico Fellini, even Ingmar Bergman. But then, I slowly realized animation and cartoons is really where it's at. Whether it's watching every single episode of Adventure Time or Courage the Cowardly Dog or watching films like Yellow Submarine or Fantasia, it really kind of got into me. I really got into those styles, and I realized cartoons are really the best way of expressing that feeling. I can easily see how drugs can influence a cartoonist to bring that style onto the screen. And whenever I talked about this, a lot of people would recommend me Ralph Bakshi. And I always knew Ralph Bakshi. I knew the name, but I never really, for some reason, I never really got around to watching his films. I knew of the film Wizards. I knew he made, like, the 70s The Lord of the Rings movie. I know he made fucking Cool World with Brad Pitt in the 90s. And I know that he's one of the revolutionary American animators, like, alongside Chuck Jones and whatnot. I only decided to watch Fritz the Cat because of two things. One, feline debauchery. And that's always a good sign. The second reason is obviously because Robert E. Crumb created Fritz the Cat. And before you guys talk about, oh, he probably doesn't know shit about Robert E. Crumb. I was ready for this. I fucking love Robert E. Crumb, just so you know. Let's try to find Fritz the Cat here. I didn't check where it was. It's definitely in here. I mean, this is basically like the greatest hits collection of, Robert E. Crumb. So obviously, Fritz the Cat is gonna take at least part of it. This is taking way too much fucking time. Where is it? Here it is. Okay. That's obviously Fritz the Cat. They're gonna have sex, and that I will not show you that because YouTube is very sensitive about that. A guy named Jason introduced me to Robert E. Crumb when I was like 15. So yeah, he totally helped me become the antisocial asshole that I am today. But he still recommended me like bands like the Cranberries and the Sundays and fucking Mazzy starring the B-52. So, you know, good job for him. I'm talking about all these things because I'm not really sure where to start with this movie because it's a very blatant film. You know, it's about the phoniness of the hippie culture and the so-called revolution that they always talked about in the 60s. You know, they're always talking about revolution, about peace, but they're fighting violence with violence. You know, they romanticize cultures that they honestly don't know shit about. And they're trying to be intellectual and deep, but not because they want to feel thoughtful and smart, but because they just want to be, you know, cool and hip. You know, it's a very shallow idea of intellectualism. You know, New York and Harlem is portrayed in an extremely gritty way. You know, violence is happening everywhere. There's also this very strong emphasis on violence within men and masculinity. There are scenes where they emphasize needles and broken bottles and blood. There's this great scene where a police shoots a black man who are in this film, black men are crows, and This scene was just so brutal. It, like, you see the blood, and you see the guts, and you see the impact of that shot. You know, it's obviously trying to portray the 60s in its ugliest image. It's trying to break away the romanticized idea that we have of the 60s. You know, like, Jimi Hendrix, Woodstock, The Doors, man. And at a certain point, when you really get down to it, that's only, you know, people who are having fun at music festivals and shit. In reality, a lot of people were going through some tough shit back then. And I like the fact that the film is trying to show you that. And what I love about this film is, honestly, Fritz himself. Fritz doesn't go through a journey in this movie like most main characters. You know, he actually learns nothing at the end of the film. You know, he's lazy, he's sleazy, he wants to bring change and the so-called revolution, but he's too stupid to know what that fucking revolution is. Not only that, when he has, like, a perfectly good person helping him out, he throws her away and tries to pursue that vague idea of a revolution and change again. And I like the fact that he's basically the embodiment of the flaws of the romanticizing, you know, the current romanticizing of the 60s that we have, probably something that was happening in the 70s, and the 80s, and the 90s, even today. So it's a very blatant film when it comes to the messages. I think artistically, that's where the film really shines, and it's really more deep. You know, the colors are very sharp. There are some great visual ideas here. One of my favorite scenes is the scene where this crow gets shot. And you can easily just show him just dying. But the way, because this crow was playing billiards before he was dying in a bar. So, and when he gets shot, each heartbeat is represented through a billiard ball going into a hole, and with the last billiard ball, the hole disappears, and the scene just cracks, and then we go back, you know, the camera kind of zooms back, and we see that the cracks are, you know, like the blood streams that's happening in his eyes, that's all cracking up, and he dies, and he just falls back, and the blood goes into the sewer system. It's an amazing scene, and it's drawn so amazingly. It's vibrant, it's edgy, you see the pencil marks, so it's very texture-filled, it's raw. And what I love about the film is also the way they did the voice work. The voice work is very conversational. It feels natural and off-kilter, you know. It's not timed, it's not intentional, because with most movies, especially like Disney films, when there's a conversation, one character speaks, the sentence ends, then the other character starts speaking. In this film, they cut each other within conversations and lines, and it's not timed. It's not like in the middle of like a perfect timing of a sentence where you can stop there and another person can just jump in. No, they speak, and while they're speaking, somebody cuts in and the other guy's still speaking, like they're actually having a conversation. It's extremely realistic, and because you notice those small things, you get into the conversation as well. So even though it's a cartoon, it's strangely immersive. You can really put yourself into the situation because you notice things that happen in real life as well. The film is, quite frankly, just amazing. I didn't think this film would get to me this much. I'm pretty sure I should just say a 4 out of 4, but it's honestly a masterpiece. It's been a while since a cartoon really got to me on this level. So, yeah, I like to call it a masterpiece, at least for now. Maybe I'm just trying to be edgy as shit, but I don't know, man. I dug the movie a whole lot. It's a fucking masterpiece, what do you know? So yeah, Fritz the Cat, go watch it if you just want to see some cats fucking in a tub. Masterpiece, bye.